Hi, I'm Chuck Smith, and welcome back to Yang Abroad. I make videos about Andrew Yang, specifically tailored to Americans living abroad. Today I'm going to talk about different policies that Yang has that could be particularly interesting to those of you living abroad. Because most of you are thinking, why should I even vote? I don't even live in the States. Maybe you don't even plan to return to the States. So today I'm going to get into that. The Freedom Dividend. So if you don't know anything else about Andrew Yang, you've heard he's an Asian man who wants to give you $1,000 a month. But you're probably wondering, I live abroad, how's that gonna work? Is he really gonna give me $1,000 a month? So actually, he gets into the video about how it works here on the H3 podcast.
What about the citizens abroad?
That is such an interesting question. So the reality is that the economic benefits become exponentially higher if the money gets spent within the country itself, rather than having a large number of citizens who, let's say, moves to another part of the world and then spend the money there. Mm-hmm. So you're a citizen, you get the dividend forever, but there's like a certain time frame after which, like, if you live abroad for a certain number of months, mm-hmm. then the dividend gets like held for you for when you come back to the country.
Interesting. So you don't lose it, it just accrues.
Yeah.
Interesting. Is there any prevention? Let's say I want to go live in Thailand because it's cheap. I go, come back in 3 years, I get all my dividends, and then I bounce back to Thailand.
yeah. So that's like the thing we're trying to avoid is that then, but then if you bounce back to Thailand, then, you know, the dividend would start accruing again. So the goal is to make it so that the vast majority of the money gets spent here.
So I think for many of us, we think, wow, that could also be an interesting retirement option as well. Medicare for all. Some of you moved abroad because you can't afford to pay for the healthcare that you need. His version will make a public option so that you can choose if you want to take the government option or if you want to keep your private insurance. And basically his idea is that he wants the government option to be so much better than the private insurance that it competes directly to the point where you decide you definitely want the government option instead of the private insurance. Along with that, he has a policy to control the cost of prescription drugs. So the government will negotiate with pharmaceutical industries to get you the best price, and they'll also base prices on international prices they see around the world. Combat climate change.
Climate change, we have to do a whole lot more. I just released a 5-point plan, which includes some of the stuff you probably hear from other places, which is try and move towards renewables. The big piece of the puzzle is that 85% of the world's emissions are from non-US sources. Yeah. So if you want to try and curb emissions in a serious way, then you have to go to Africa and say to them, you know that coal-burning power plant that China's installing for you for free? I'm going to try and convince you that these solar panels and wind turbines are a better option. And so then you have to subsidize that to a very high degree if you're going to make that competitive. The third thing is that we should be trying to make our communities more resilient and literally and figuratively move our people to higher ground where, you know, if there's a hurricane, who suffers? Poor people who don't have great shelter or cars they can get into to drive away. And anyone who thinks this stuff is a little doom and gloom, we're already moving climate refugees in the United States. We already took a town of people in Louisiana where their land had essentially become underwater and uninhabitable. And we said, well, it's time to move you. So if we're doing that there, then we should start looking at other places where, frankly, that's starting to happen. Mm-hmm. And it's happening in more and more places around the country, not just Louisiana. The fourth thing is that we have to try and undo some of the damage we're doing. So that involves reforesting tracts of land. It involves trying to repair some of the oceans by seeding plankton beds. It sounds a little far out, but 4-8% of marine life in the Atlantic Ocean is dying now every year. So if you extrapolate that over time, you're talking about massive, massive problems. And so we can't just try and do less of the bad. We have to try and undo some of the damage.
Democracy dollars.
So right now, our government has been overrun by corporate lobbyists and moneyed interests. And if you are a lawmaker, you have very tough choices because you have the voters on one side, and then you have these companies that are just giving you money for your reelection and everything. And you spend all your time dialing for dollars, and a lot of that ends up touching the lobbyists and the corporates. So how do we free our legislators up from this bondage?
What we do is we give every American voter 100 democracy dollars that are use it or lose it. So if you don't use it in 2019, you get 100 new dollars in 2020. And with these democracy dollars, every voter could then give $100 to that legislator. And so the legislator's incentives then completely change. Because if I'm a congressperson, I have 10,000 people give me 100 democracy dollars, that's $1 million. And then when the lobbyist comes and says, I've got 50,000 for you, you can say, I don't care about your 50,000. And so this way you unify the popular will and the money in a way that then restores our government to us, the voters and the American people. And what I said on the stage was that this would wash out the lobbyist cash by a ratio of 8-1. So if you are a sensible legislator, you're going to start doing what the people want because that's where the money will be.
Modernize voting. With Democrats Abroad, you can go to one of the 200 polling stations around the world for people like you. But maybe you don't live near one of those 200 polling stations. And likely your only choices to vote will be either by mail or by fax, which both seem incredibly outdated. So, under the Yang administration, he plans to research into blockchain and other technologies to enable voting, for example, by app, but also very securely. But of course, technology currently isn't available yet, so that will need to be researched. But we still need to make steps to make sure that we're going in this direction, so that more people can vote and be involved in our democracy. More than a handshake, my plan to better serve our veterans. Now, I have to admit, the section on veterans I'm the least familiar with, unfortunately. But Shaving with Tilly made an amazing video.
If you're a veteran, then you have experience having around more than a dozen commanders, captains, majors, colonels. You've seen good ones, you've seen bad ones. And you can recognize the intangibles that make someone a good leader. You know it when you see it, when this is a guy you can follow.
Okay.
And I see that absolutely in Andrew Yang, because he's not, he didn't want this office. He did this as a last resort for his kids.
Yeah, okay.
And as a dad myself of little kids, this is the reason I'm here. Because I'm not going to look him in the eye and say that dad didn't fight for you. Dad wasn't willing to go stand in the ring for you. You're goddamn right I am.
Hell yeah.
My kids are not going to go hungry. They're not going to experience poverty because I'm here with my brother and sister veterans, and we're not giving up an inch of this ground until we get President Yang elected.
Woo! That is a hell of a statement!
Of course, this video is quite short to get into the details of every policy I talk about. See his policy page and find more information about the policy that's most interesting to you. So if you like what you saw, like, subscribe, and share with your friends. Until next time.